Hello all. In this video, we'll be looking at Jeremiah chapter 24. So open your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 24. And as per usual, we'll go through pretty well verse by verse. It's a shorter chapter than the previous one by about half. And it's pretty straightforward, simple to understand. It's a parable. It's a parable about two baskets of figs. One basket had good figs, and the other basket had bad figs. So we'll just read the first couple of verses, and then we'll start our comments. Chapter 24, verse 1. The Lord showed me, and there were two baskets of figs set before the temple of the Lord after Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and the princes of Judah, with the craftsmen and smiths from Jerusalem, and had brought them to Babylon. So this is probably the occasion of the Feast of First Fruits, when during that time crops and fruits were brought before the Lord, set before the temple. Although at the first fruits really has to do with the wave sheaf of the barley sheaf. So it could also be connected more with the Feast of Tabernacles. But so we're not too clear on that. But in the story or in the parable that the Lord showed Jeremiah anyway, he saw these two basket of figs, one bad, one good, set before the temple of the Lord. And the occasion, we may connect it with, this will help us understand it a little bit, chapter 21, you remember chapter 21, verse 1 and 2, where we get the king of Judah, Zedekiah. And this may be a further response to Zedekiah's request. Chapter 21, verse 1, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord when King Zedekiah sent to him these two individuals to inquire of the Lord. Verse 2, for Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, makes war against us. So he had this question, king of Babylon is making war against us. And, you know, how's this going to turn out, Jeremiah? Well, we know what Jeremiah always answered him. It's not going to turn out good for you unless you repent and unless you surrender to Nebuchadnezzar. So Zedekiah was the last king of Judah. You can read about him also in Ezekiel chapter 21, where the Lord says, remove the crown and then overturn, and that the crown of the king of David, and the throne of David, would not be placed on the head of the king of David till he whose comes, whose right it is. And we know that to be the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the captivity of Zedekiah, the last king of Judah, was the beginning of what we call the times of the Gentiles, when God took the kingdom from Israel and gave it over into the hands of the Gentiles, starting with Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. So I say all that to help us understand here. Because Jeremiah can, as far as chronology is concerned, can sort of jump back and forth a little bit, because the two kings that are mentioned here in the opening verses of chapter 24 with the parable of the basket of figs were the kings that were actually before King Nebuchadnezzar. So we have here Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim. So just to explain this a little further, there were three attacks against Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar. And the first one was against Jehoiakim. And then some Jehoiakim and some of the Israelites were taken into captivity to Babylon. And then Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, experienced the second attack by Nebuchadnezzar. And the reason why Nebuchadnezzar keeps attacking, because these Jewish kings don't obey Nebuchadnezzar. They don't accept that they're now vassals of Nebuchadnezzar, and they're trying to make leagues with other nations to overthrow his rule. And so a certain company was taken captivity then. In 605 BC, the first attack occurred under the king Jehoiakim, and we read about that in Daniel chapter 1. And in that captivity, Daniel and his friends and others of the royal seed were taken into captivity. That was 605 BC. And then following that, when Jeconiah, or we read about him earlier, Coniah, sat on the throne, Nebuchadnezzar attacked again and took some into captivity. That was 597 BC, and Ezekiel was involved in that captivity. So Daniel in the first one, Ezekiel in the second one, and each time a certain batch of the Jews were taken into Babylon. And the third and final one was the one that finally Nebuchadnezzar had enough, and Zedekiah was taken captive. And we had read about him in chapter 21, where Nebuchadnezzar slaughtered his sons before his face, I think seven sons, and then poked out Zedekiah's eyes. So the last thing that he saw was the murder of his sons. And then Nebuchadnezzar took him to captivity in Babylon. That ended it. That ended Jewish rule. And Nebuchadnezzar destroyed Jerusalem completely, tore it all apart, burned it down, you know, threw all the stones. Solomon's temple was totally destroyed. That was in 586 BC. So now we're looking at this. And Jeremiah gets this vision or this word from the Lord. He says, set before the temple of the Lord, verse 1, after Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim. So this is occurring after the second captivity. And so that's why I say it really concerns Zedekiah. And an answer to Zedekiah that we saw in chapter 1, Zedekiah's inquiry, you know, is the king of Babylon going to come and attack us and so on? And basically, Jeremiah says yes, so you better repent. But obviously, Zedekiah doesn't listen to Jeremiah. In fact, Jeremiah was persecuted under Zedekiah and by Zedekiah's men. And so as we go on, we'll just read verse 1 one more time. The Lord showed me, and there were two baskets of figs set before the temple of the Lord after Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away Jeconiah. So that's the second captivity. The son of Jehoiakim, which was the first captivity, where Daniel and his friends were carried away and others of the royal seat. And the princes of Judah and the craftsmen and the smiths from Jerusalem and brought them to Babylon. You see, in that second captivity of Jeconiah, the skilled craftsmen and smiths from Jerusalem were taken to Babylon. See, what Nebuchadnezzar was doing, he was taking sort of the cream of the crop. In the first captivity under Jehoiakim, I mentioned that he took Daniel and his friends to royal seed. So they were like the ruling classes and, you know, the ones related to the royal line and so on. They were taken first. And the second captivity, the tradespeople and those who were skilled in you know, with their hands and that type of thing, Nebuchadnezzar took. So basically, he was taking them for his own kingdom. He wanted talented people. He wanted educated people. He wanted, you know, dignified royal type people that would enhance his kingdom. And initially, he wasn't going to destroy Jerusalem, but because of the you know, the obstinacy of the Jews, and especially of Zedekiah and their stiff necks and refusing to submit to him. Finally, as I say, he had enough and he destroyed the city. But all of this was in the counsels of God. So verse 2 now goes back to this batch of figs. One basket had very good figs, like the figs that are first ripe. And the other basket had very bad figs, which could not be eaten. They were so bad. So one basket, very nice figs. The other basket, they were rotten. They were no good. Not edible at all. Then the Lord said to me, "What do you see, Jeremiah?" So the Lord asked Jeremiah, "What are you looking at?" And he said, Jeremiah says, "Figs, good figs, very good, and bad, very bad, which cannot be eaten. They are so bad." And the word of the Lord came to me saying, "Thus says the Lord." A reminder here, it's the word of the Lord. And Jeremiah uses that again and again. I think someone has counted like 150 plus times Jeremiah uses the word of the Lord. And he does it, we saw in the last message on chapter 23, The Lord told him, don't use oracle anymore. You know, I'm tired of that word with the false prophets. So it's the word of the Lord. Don't use burden. Use the word of the Lord. And the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah saying, thus said the God of Israel, verse 5, like these good figs, so will I acknowledge those who are carried away captive from Judah, whom I have sent out of this place for their own good. Now, this is interesting. Those who had already been taken into captivity, you know, Daniel and his friends in that group under the first captivity, and then Ezekiel and the others, the tradespeople and so on, under Jeconiah, that group. And they, the Lord says here, for their own good. Like, the captivity in Babylon wasn't going to be bad. If they would just obey him, settle down, and he wanted them to produce in their kingdom. And we know the story that, for example, Daniel and his three friends, they rose to the top under God's sovereignty, but to the top of the kingdom in the bureaucracy of Babylon. And so if they would just follow the Lord and obey him, that his judgment was coming upon the city for their sins, if they submitted to Nebuchadnezzar, God would have mercy upon them. In fact, bless them in the land. We see that's exactly what happened. That's what happened for their own good. So it was a bad thing that happened, but it was for their own good if they took it the right way. And I'm thinking of Romans chapter 8, verse 28. You know, all things work together for good for those that love God and that are called according to purpose. His purpose doesn't mean that all things are good, but all things, even the bad things, God can work together for good for those who love God. And so this is exactly what we have here. Whom I sent out of this place, verse 5, for their own good. It's an amazing verse. Into the land of the Chaldeans, that's the Babylonians. For I will set my eyes on them for good, and I will bring them back to this land, and I will build them and not pull them down, and I will plant them and not pluck them up. He would bless them in Babylon. And of course, following that, under the Persian kings, their situation there under the Persian reign was even better than under the Babylonian reign. And then, but God would bring some of them back to the land. And we know that, we'll read more about that. The length of the captivity, that comes out in the next chapter, chapter 25, 70 years. And then verse 7 is lovely as well. Then I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. For they shall return to me with their whole heart. And that may have a future application, but I believe probably more specifically, it's dealing with the remnant in Babylon and Persia. And we see ones, you know, like Daniel, like Daniel's friends. There's others later, like Zerubbabel, who came back to establish the worship of the Lord. And then we see like Ezra and then Nehemiah and these ones. So there were godly ones amongst them who came back, and the Lord would be with them. He stirred their spirit to return to the land. And then verse 8, and as the bad figs which cannot be eaten, they are so bad, surely thus says the Lord, so I will give up Zedekiah, the king of Judah. So, you know, Zedekiah and his followers, you know, his princes, the residue of Jerusalem, those that are left over from the preceding two captivities, the one in 597 or 605 and 597, I think were the dates. Yeah, 605 Daniel, 597 Ezekiel, and now 586 BC was the final attack and destruction of Jerusalem. So I will give up Zedekiah, the king of Judah, his princes, the residue of Jerusalem who remain in this land and who dwell in the land of Egypt. So some had gone down into Egypt because they were in league with the Egyptians with the hope that they would be able to overthrow Nebuchadnezzar, but that ended up as a disaster. And I will deliver them to trouble into all the kingdoms of the earth for their harm, to be a reproach and a byword, a taunt, a curse in all the places where I shall drive them. So just in contrast to the ones who submitted to the discipline of the Lord and who followed Nebuchadnezzar, who submitted to his rule and went to Babylon, the Lord said it would be for their good, and I will bless them there. But with the bad figs, they would be scattered in the nations, but it would be for their harm. it wouldn't work out for them. And I will send, verse 10, I will send the sword and the famine and the pestilence among them until they are consumed from the land that I gave to them and their fathers. You know, that's according to the Mosaic covenant, which was conditional. You know, the different covenants, the Abrahamic covenant was not conditional. It was unilateral, not bilateral. And so God swore by himself to Abraham. So it was on God, no matter what, how the people behaved, ultimately it will come to pass by his sovereign grace. But the Mosaic covenant, the giving of the law at Sinai and everything, you know, they had to promise to do their part. All that the Lord has said, we will do, they said. But of course, while Moses was still getting the law on the mount, they were down below breaking the first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before me. So it just shows how the heart of man is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. We read that in Romans chapter 8. So there's some interesting promises here in connection with obedience, that even when we're in trial and bad things happen, if we're following the Lord, if we love him, if we're walking in obedience, and bad things can still happen, trials can happen, even when we're trying to do what is right, you know, trying to follow the Lord, yet the Lord allows it for our own good. Let's lay a hold of that for today. And may the Lord encourage you and bless you as you continue to study through the book of Jeremiah. Amen.